just going to make a note in the script to
Hi everyone, this is Bailey with House Natural Resources. We'll just be getting started in just a moment here, and we will see you soon.
All right, thank you, Bailey, and welcome to the House Natural Resources Republican Forum of the 117th Congress, titled Critical Minerals Addressing Supply Chain Challenges and Rising Demand. This event is not an official hearing or meeting of the House Committee on Natural Resources. Documents produced to support this forum may not necessarily reflect the views of the committee or its members. However, because committee Democrats have neglected to hold a hearing on this important topic, the Republican members of the committee are meeting today to hear from a broad panel of experts who can testify to various aspects of the critical mineral supply chain, global challenges in making those supply chains more secure, and perhaps a few ideas for how we might improve the situation. To preserve order and decorum during our forums, we will adhere to the spirit of our committee rules. Please note that members are responsible for their own microphones, and members can be muted by staff only to avoid inadvertent background noise. Members or witnesses experiencing technical problems should inform committee staff immediately. I will now recognize myself for an opening statement before introducing the witnesses. We are here today to discuss a global problem, the striking shortage of critical minerals needed for our future. This has been a growing concern for years, but it appears that we are now approaching a tipping point. Recent reports and modeling have shown that global demand for renewable energy, electric vehicles, battery storage, and other technologies will vastly outstrip the known supply of resources necessary to build them. The difference between what we have and what we will need is several orders of magnitude. Even President Biden has acknowledged this issue, issuing an executive order on America's supply chains in February. The administration has set several ambitious goals for renewable energy deployment in the US, which of course requires major increases in minerals to make these technologies function. I am glad that the administration has acknowledged this reality, but the topic of where those minerals should come from is very much up for debate. For instance, it is clear that minerals recycling will not produce nearly enough to meet demand, and new sources will need to be mined. So I am disappointed that this administration and many of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle have actively supported legislation to kill domestic mining projects, including some of the most promising mineral deposits in North America. Obstacles to domestic mining and extraction are part of a very large, very complex problem. Unlike other resources like oil or coal, critical minerals is a broad term referring to dozens of commodities, all with different price points, rarities, and applications. They are found in different geological formations and extracted in different ways. For instance, the lithium in my state is primarily produced from brine, instead of being dug up in a traditional underground mine. Many critical minerals are only produced as byproducts from other minerals during the refining process, which complicates the economic landscape even further. Another major problem and hurdle is the hegemony of one nation in the global minerals marketplace, and that's China. I am deeply concerned by how far China has come towards complete control of this market, having begun major investments in mines refining capacity in the last 15 to 20 years. Meanwhile, the import reliance of the United States on foreign suppliers has risen sharply over the same time period. If we don't take action to make serious changes now, it is not an exaggeration to say that in the future, we will be built by Chinese-owned mines, refineries, and factories. The economic and national security implications of this are troubling enough on their own, but not securing our supply chains will also create another cost, a humanitarian one. Some of the commodities most valuable for renewable energy development, for example, are often found in countries with unacceptable labor and environmental practices. Cobalt from the Democratic Republic of the Congo is one of the most notorious examples, but it is far from a unique case. The United States and our allies must find opportunities to support sustainable, responsible mining and refining practices. and we must maximize production in nations with satisfactory standards in place. I recognize that this is much easier said than done and will involve collaboration across multiple branches of government, but we owe it to ourselves and to others to come up with some meaningful solutions. The alternative to knowingly allow mineral development to grow despite terrible worker and environmental impacts is not acceptable. I sincerely believe this issue is a bipartisan one. We already know there is bipartisan concern about supplying the resources for our technological future. And I would welcome my colleagues across the aisle to join in future discussions about securing our mineral supply chains. It is important to consider all the tools at our disposal, from increasing recycling technologies to permitting improvements for domestic mines to building new smelters to support this incredibly important economic sector. The longer we do nothing, the worse the problem will become. I thank the witnesses for being here today, and I look forward to this important discussion. Before I go any further, I would like to recognize the Dean of the House and the former chairman of the committee, the gentleman from Alaska, Mr. Don Young, to make some statements.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You may not be chairman yet, but you will be chairman someday. And I thank you for your opening statement. What you say is very true. This is an issue which I have been very much interested in all my career, is about the critical elements that we need, the importation and in fact use of, and how it's put at the mercy of other countries. We have them. We have them in your state, and every state in the union, particularly Alaska, has every known mineral which we need, and rare earths all the way down the line. A lot of it's been set aside by action of the Congress. Now, the big challenge we have is the 30 by 30 by Mr. Biden. Be sure that if that was to get legs, they would pick the areas which have the, I would say, finds of critical minerals which we badly need. So that's another part of this program. And as you mentioned before, the need and supply for, it's ironic, the need and supply for these minerals are supposedly aimed at stopping climate change, and yet they don't want to be mined. I don't understand the hypocrisy of that, but it's crucially important for this nation, not only for national security, but as you mentioned, for humanitarian purposes. It's a needed product, products. We have them. We can develop them safely, and we develop them environmentally sound. That can be done better than other countries. You know, in my state, like I say, we have a huge minerals and rare earths available. We know where it is, but some people want to set it aside and not use it yet. That's what we're using, including lithium and our so-called batteries, etc. So again, thank you for having this presentation. I just looked at the witness list. You have a great group of witnesses, and I would like to stay with you and ask some questions, but we're all on the same page. I hope they can give us some information we can use in the future. I have another prior engagement I have to participate in. I thank you again, Mr. Chairman, for your efforts of putting forth the need for this in this forum. So God bless you all.
Thank you, Don, and thank you for the wisdom that you bring to the Congress and to our committee. And you did a good lead in there. We have a great panel of witnesses. I'm going to briefly introduce them before their testimony. The first is Mr. Dan McGroarty, principal from Carmet Strategy Group Incorporated. Mr. Tim Gould, head of Division for Energy Supply Outlooks and Investments at the International Energy Agency. Mr. Reed Blakemore, deputy director of Global Energy Center at the Atlantic Council. Dr. Michael Motes, professor of metallurgical engineering and director of the O'Keefe Institute, Missouri University of Science and Technology. Dr. Ian Lang, director of the Mineral and Energy Economics Program at the Colorado School of Mines. Ms. Abigail Wolf, director of our Center for Critical Mineral Strategy, Securing America's Future Energy. And finally, Ms. Laurel Sayer, president and CEO of Perpetua Resources. Witnesses must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes. After your testimony is complete, please remember to mute yourself to avoid any inadvertent background noise. I will allow the entire panel to testify before members begin questioning the witnesses. With that, I want to recognize our first witness, Mr. Dan McGroarty. You now have 5 minutes to testify. I think you're still muted, Dan. Hold on just a second.
Sorry about that.
There you go.
Thank you, Chairman Westerman, Dean Young, members of the committee. thank you for the opportunity to take part in this forum with my fellow witnesses today. One advantage of the virtual sessions is the ability to use a visual backdrop and not simply to prevent the camera from picking up whatever mayhem may take place behind the speaker. What I'm using as a backdrop today isn't a shot of a particular critical mineral or metal. When the subject is U.S. critical mineral dependency, there's simply too many to choose from, but fireflies in a field. It's the inspiration for the firefly algorithm that determines the optimal routing protocol for data zipping across a 5G network. Fireflies help us understand a major difference as we step up from 4G to 5G. We're used to mammoth cell towers relaying signals 5 miles, 10 miles at a time. 5G is different. Network engineers even have made up a word for it. They say 5G is densified. In a space where a few 4G towers were sufficient for as much as 100 square miles of coverage, in 5G, thousands, maybe tens of thousands of small cell nodes will move our data. They're the fireflies of 5G. Now, what's the connection to natural resources? A densified system requires a lot of advanced materials. If the US is serious about not relying on China's Huawei for our 5G, with all the risks that carries for national security, we need to factor that physicality into the network we build. So what are the 5G criticals? Start with a single heavy rare earth, erbium for 5G fiber optics. Add in cesium, up to now a niche material in cesium clocks, but in 5G, it's required to speed gun the network's nanosecond bit transfers. We'll need graphite by the ton for 5G towers, gallium for 5G semiconductor chips. There are more materials, but I'll stop there and make 3 points. First, the U.S. is 100% import dependent for each of the minerals and metals I've just mentioned. Second, in each case, China is the world's leading producer. And third, the U.S. hosts known resources for each one. So if the U.S. allows our posture of dependency to persist, that is a dependency of our own making. And it's the same story. Sometimes it's the same metals. When we look at hardening our national grid or the Internet of Things or quantum computing, that's in addition to the materials required for renewable energy and to develop the next gen weapons platforms we depend on to keep the peace and prevail in conflict. So as a mental exercise, I'd suggest, let's not fixate on how a metal comes out of the ground, where it comes from. Let's look at what that metal goes into and where it takes us. But if we've entered the tech metals age, we're not lost without a map in this new world. We can take a page from the successful effort to reverse decades of dependency on foreign oil. What was the secret to achieving American energy independence? An all of the above strategy that didn't pit one form of energy against another. It embraced oil and natural gas and coal and wind and solar and hydro, biofuels and nuclear power. The common denominator, energy produced in the US. It's time to apply that all of the above approach to the critical mineral crisis, and it is that. This time, all of the above means encouraging and incentivizing traditional mining and refining and recycling and reclamation and unconventional recoveries from historic mine tailings. With the critical mineral shortfalls we're facing, an all of the above supply strategy is the only one that makes sense. That means encouraging lithium recovery from boron tailings, as is happening right now in California, rare earths and other criticals from coal waste. Looking ahead, it means critical mineral recoveries from red mud in Louisiana, from graphite deposits in Alaska, and even if Congress can sort out Good Samaritan legislation, critical minerals from abandoned mine lands to solve two problems at once, providing domestic supply and improving the catastrophic economics of AML cleanups. Further along the supply chain, it means seeing our metal smelters as national assets, encouraging ways to adapt them for a range of critical mineral recoveries. That's happening now in Utah, where rhenium and tellurium are being recovered by adding new circuits to copper smelting. And it means putting a priority on processing methods that are versatile enough to accept different feedstocks, like continuous ion exchange, proven to extract heavy rare earths from a deposit in Texas and from Pennsylvania coal waste as well. That same all of the above approach can be applied to the policies Congress puts in place to strengthen critical mineral supply, be addressed with an amendment of 10 words, maybe less. If you look up the federal tax depletion schedule, you'll see 94 materials listed there. Sand and gravel are there. Riprap is there. Even oyster shells are in there. But as for what's not mentioned, rare earth elements are not listed. In fact, 13 of the 35 minerals on the government critical list are not named in the tax depletion schedule. And for 8 of those 13, the US government is 100% import dependent. If these minerals and metals are critical, if we want US companies to explore for them, to mine, refine, reclaim, recycle, and otherwise produce them, shouldn't we create a tax depletion category for critical minerals that reflects that importance? To conclude, I'll come full circle. Critical minerals aren't critical because of where they come from. They're critical because of where they take us. American ingenuity, innovation, and investment can all do a lot, but the power of the private sector can do far more if public policy sends a strong signal that critical minerals matter to the technology revolution transforming our world and to America's place as the leader in that transformation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. I'll now recognize our next witness, Mr. Tim Gold, to testify for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much indeed. I hope you can see my slides. I would like to first of all thank the distinguished representatives for the opportunity to join you here today. And for those of you who may not be familiar with the International Energy Agency, since our founding in the 1970s, we've evolved to become the world's leading authority on global energy issues, providing data, analysis, and advice to governments and industry across the full energy spectrum. And as the energy sector changes, so too do the IEA's priorities. And that explains our keen interest in today's topic, because as the ranking member mentioned, the energy sector is becoming a major force in demand for key metals and minerals. And this will intensify as we deploy the energy technologies that we will need to avoid severe impacts from climate change. And we recently released new analysis on this topic and found that rapid energy transitions would require at least a quadrupling of overall mineral requirements for clean energy technologies to 2040, and maybe up to 6-time increase. And the main factor behind that is mineral demand for EVs and battery storage, followed closely by the mineral needs for expanding electricity networks, and then the growth of low carbon power generation. And when you start to look at the details, you see that there are increases that are significantly larger than that 4-to-6-time range, in particular for lithium, followed by graphite, cobalt, and nickel. And that has strong implications for mining companies looking to supply the energy sector. Today, worldwide revenue from coal production is 10 times larger than revenue from energy transition minerals. However, there is a rapid reversal in that situation in an energy transition, creating a strategic opportunity for companies to position themselves in growing sectors. This is a global picture on the screen, but these opportunities apply in some cases at country level, particularly so in the United States, that there's large resources of both coal and critical minerals. So there are huge potential benefits here for new activity and employment that could put the United States at the forefront of efforts to provide stable and reliable supplies of these minerals. However, when we look at the supply situation today, and there is that strong concentration of supply chains that we've talked about, especially when it comes to process and refining. And naturally, that increases the risks that could arise from physical disruption or trade restrictions or other developments in major producing countries. And there are other factors in play as well, including relatively long lead times for new projects, so permitting issues, resource quality, and so on. I'd like to conclude with 6 recommendations on what needs to be done, and that's based on the IEA's existing leadership role on energy security issues, but also draws inspiration from existing national and international initiatives, including those pursued by the United States. And the first of those measures to ensure adequate and diversified investment, giving clear signals to companies about future needs, streamlining permitting procedures to shorten lead times, or providing financing support to de-risk projects. It's also vital that governments step up support for technology innovation. This can reduce mineral intensities and open up important possibilities for substitution. A third area, as mentioned by the ranking member, is recycling. It's well established for some bulk metals like steel, aluminium, and copper, but not yet for lithium or rare earth elements. This will need to change, although, as was pointed out, it will not remove the need for investment in new supply. A fourth area is the resilience of supply chains and market transparency. As we know at the IEA from our existing emergency response programs, if you have regular market assessments, good market data, periodic stress tests, that can all help governments and other stakeholders identify possible weak points and devise the necessary responses. And the world does need to step up efforts to tackle the environmental and social impacts of mineral developments, including emissions, local pollution, treatment of worker safety, and welfare. Although in saying this, I'd like to make clear that emissions along the mineral supply chain do not negate the climate advantages of clean energy technologies. And finally, in our view, there is a need for strengthened international collaboration amongst producers and consumers. And in that respect, for our part at the International Energy Agency, we stand ready to work closely with the United States and other members of the IEA family to anticipate and navigate potential vulnerabilities and avoid damaging outcomes for our economies and our planet. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Tom, for that that report. And we're going to now go to Reed Blakemore. You're now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Ranking Member Westerman and the other distinguished members of the subcommittee. My name is Reed Blakemore, and I serve as Deputy Director at the Global Energy Center of the Atlantic Council. Before I begin, I should note that my remarks and written testimony represent my observations and therefore do not necessarily represent the views of my colleagues or institution. Given the breadth of expertise on this panel and the limited time for my remarks, I'll focus my remarks on three observations of the global mineral supply chain, those being the complex economics and interdependency within steps of the supply chain, the impact of lowest common denominator barriers to entry for new participants, and how the scale of the minerals challenge bears upon policy options for supply chain resiliency and security. First, in the upstream and midstream, most critical minerals are found as subdeposits during extraction or found as byproducts of processing, and therefore need appropriate market conditions in place to be retrieved in addition to or at the expense of other co-located materials. Most minerals also often need to be sent elsewhere in order to continue to pass through the value chain, frequently resulting in small physical amounts of key minerals being aggregated from multiple sources. A good example here is tellurium, which is most frequently found as a byproduct of copper refining, but is only retrieved at a rate of roughly 0.9 grams per ton of refined copper ore. The result is a highly interdependent value chain, wherein the market conditions necessary to incentivize the retrieval of minerals as byproducts might vary from those necessary for a refiner to process those ores into concentrate and then sell finished material into a component manufacturer. These issues are then compounded by a lack of strong market governance structures and price volatility, which together create obstacles for operators who are seeking certainty around sourcing and offtake, inhibits decisions regarding production volumes, and increases overall business risk. This is what has maligned previous attempts at patching single vulnerabilities in segments of the supply chain. For example, the 2015 bankruptcy of the Mountain Pass mine in California. Overcoming the uncertainty related to supply chain interdependency is why there is a growing attention to more integrated approaches to the supply chain, which ensure input and offtake certainty. Though the scale of financial and operational commitment necessary to achieve a fully integrated supply chain is beyond the reach of many single companies or countries, which leads to my second observation. Though generally abundant, most critical mineral production is currently limited to a few key countries or geographies, with one country often holding a significant amount of market share in each supply chain. New components of a mineral supply chain need to manage cost-intensive factors, ranging from geology of the mine and associated mineral extraction, to political and environmental risk, to price volatility and market uncertainty. China has seen considerable success in limiting or circumventing these factors through an integrated industrial strategy that includes subsidized investment, limited regulation, as well as production quotas and direct offtake support. This advantages Chinese producers with significantly lower overhead costs, improved tolerance to price volatility, and maximize margins while pushing out competitors with a higher cost of production. Furthermore, it establishes a lowest common denominator set of competitive conditions that allows Chinese production to consistently compete as the lowest cost producer, strengthening share of upstream and midstream production amidst continued efforts elsewhere to accelerate minerals demand. Consequently, even though demand growth signals should be encouraging new market participants, Market share is too often closed off to companies operating without the levels of support necessary to meet these lowest common denominator factors. Finally, consideration must be given to the scale of critical minerals import dependency and the amount of time necessary to solve any number of these challenges. As it stands, many countries have or are in the process of building their own critical minerals lists. Together, for example, the lists of the United States, Japan, the European Union, Australia, and Canada comprise over 46 minerals and materials, each with their own upstream dynamics, intensity of processing in the midstream, and volumes needed to meet componentry demand in the downstream. Of those 46 minerals, 16 are in common. A singular critical mineral strategy that fails to take into account the nuance between these different minerals ecosystems risks being too broad to truly make a difference against the pressures I just mentioned. Meanwhile, standing up new segments of the supply chain is a significant time investment, particularly in the upstream, where currently the development of a new mine can take over a decade. Building resiliency or alternative sources of supply across the supply chain can also take a considerable amount of time, with underwhelming results given the urgency of the challenge that we've all discussed thus far. This means that while the recognition of the minerals that we deem critical is an important first step, establishing the criticality of these minerals in relation to each other is a necessary second step to prioritize where action can be most effective in light of significant costs, time expenditure, and investment risk. To conclude, mineral supply chains will demand our attention for the foreseeable future, especially as efforts to deploy new technologies and clean energy resources continue at current levels. Yet, even as policies are developed to ensure that supply chains remain resilient, well-governed, and sustainable, careful attention must be paid to the behavior of the markets within these supply chains, as well as the scale of establishing resiliency across a wide range of unique minerals and metals. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Reed. You and Tim and Dan have all done a great job of outlining the challenges before us and also offering some practical solutions. And next, I want to recognize Dr. Moats for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Westman. I appreciate the opportunity to talk today and appreciate all the committee members for the opportunity to talk about a topic that I'm quite passionate about as a professor of metallurgical engineering and the director of the Thomas J. O'Keefe Institute for the Sustainable Supply of Strategic Minerals. What I'd like to really focus on today, and many of the things that I was prepared to talk about, the previous witnesses have already highlighted on. And so I just wanna reiterate a few and then maybe give a few more details and maybe some possible things that they didn't talk about, which first of all, when we talk about critical minerals, many of these critical minerals come from other metal supply chains. And therefore, whoever controls the metal supply chain controls the critical minerals. And when we focus on deposits and mines, which are obviously the beginning of the supply chain, as you can see from the earlier slides, the concentration of the ability to do smelting and refining dominates who controls the market in many cases. And so if you look over the last 25 years in the United States, we've had a dramatic shrinking of our smelting capacity and refining capacity. For example, the US aluminum smelters have decreased from 22 to 7. While the Chinese have increased production in refined aluminum by 20-fold. U.S. copper refineries have decreased from 7 to 2, while the Chinese have increased production by 6. The U.S. lead smelters have gone from 3 to 0. We have 0 primary lead smelters left in the United States. The Chinese have increased primary lead production by 12-fold. And so with the ability to produce the raw materials, the metals that we need, many of the metals that the IEA points out that we need are not even on our critical mineral list. They're copper, they're zinc, they're steel, they're aluminum. We need the ability to have smelters in the United States to bring in domestic resources, domestic mineral concentrates, and also international or imported sources. So as we're developing mines, mines produce mineral concentrates, not metals. We need smelters in the United States, and we need to reverse the trend. And we often focus on China, but at the same time, over those last 25 years, the European countries and the Japanese have maintained their metal supply. And so I asked Congress, why is that? Is it a policy relation? Is it a location because we built our smelters next to mines and not at places where we can easily transport concentrate from around the world to feed our smelters? I think we have to do a deep dive into why American smelters are not competitive. And is it because of the reasons that Mr. Blakemore reiterated? Or are there other underlying conditions? We also need to consider that for all of the lithium ion battery materials that we need, the lithium, the nickel, the cobalt. And so I propose to to Congress and to this committee that you may want to consider for the smaller tonnage mineral, you know, critical minerals, those are like tellurium, gallium, indium, bismuth, germanium. Maybe we need to have similar to what the FDA has with the Orphan Drug Act, where there's not enough of a market to drive drug innovation, but they sell a placeholder in line to get to the front of drug approval. Is there some policy that the US can enact to encourage the production of these minor metals, maybe a Strategic Metals Act or something, similar to what the US government does for beryllium? The federal government should also look at partial financing, helping companies buy into mineral assets and mines in other countries to bring concentrates to the United States that contain these critical minerals so that the local smelters can produce them in a responsible manner. And finally, maybe we should be discussing facility offtakes or facilitating offtake agreements between green energy companies and metal producing companies, where the green energy companies provide some of the capital to build the smelters, to provide, you know, a reliable source from responsible minerals. And ultimately, if we're going to rebuild our mineral supply chain and our metal supply chain here in the United States, we need a workforce. And as an educator, I'm one of a few people who are an attractive metallurgical engineering professor in the United States. There are only 11 ABET accredited mining engineering programs and 8 metallurgical engineering programs. In fact, one university in China has more professors in extractive metallurgy than the entire United States. Policymakers should consider targeting these programs and providing resources to show that to university professors that these programs that produce mining engineers and metallurgical engineers are critical to our future, critical to the sustainability of our industries. And maybe they need to form a innovation center to foster research in mining and metallurgy to target specific critical mineral recovery from domestic resources. And so I think that Congress has the opportunity to really reverse and move forward in smelter production as well as the mineral assets. I thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Moats. You brought out a lot of good points there. You know, as a fellow engineer, I understand how we have a shortage of especially mining and metallurgical engineers in the country. That was highlighted a few years ago when we had the Gold King mine disaster, and we found out that EPA and the Department of Interior had very few mining engineers on staff, and there's definitely a shortage of those folks. And you also talked about extracting these critical minerals and rare earths from existing supply streams. I found out recently there's a company in my district called US Vanadium. Mm-hmm. They're one of the only vanadium manufacturers in the United States, and they use pet coke and extract the vanadium out of pet coke. There just needs to be a lot more capacity at their facility to meet the future vanadium demands. We're going to move on. I'm going to recognize Dr. Ling to testify for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about this important topic. My name is Ian Lang. I'm director of the Mineral Energy Economics Program at the Colorado School of Mines. My past experience as a senior economist at the Council of Economic Advisors for both the Trump and Biden administrations strengthens my belief that this issue is something of bipartisan concern. There's three issues that I want to sort of highlight today during the discussion of the mineral supply chain: permitting of new mines, the economic structure of the midstream, the refining and processing sector, and the impact of uncertainty on investment in this area. I know we're not trying to do a whodunit novel, so I will try to lead with some policy suggestions or at least some ideas. Figuring out a way to speed up mine permitting process while without sacrificing public input will be important. The midstream sector, as everyone's mentioned already, is very important. And so ways to buy down some risk for firms to enter that area is important. Government can act as an anchor customer, and those kind of things can help other firms enter because they realize that it's there for the long haul, or those assets will be there for the long haul. Okay, as for permitting of new mines, so reshoring has been something that's been discussed in both the Trump and the Biden administrations. And in the mining sector, this is relatively straightforward to do. We just have to sort of let ourselves use the minerals that we have in the US. Permitting of mining operations on federal lands, especially, is a process filled with indefinite or unknown timetables and much uncertainty. And this uncertainty reduces investors' interest in the industry or in the products. ultimately limiting the ability of the U.S. to mine the minerals needed and create jobs up and down the supply chain. Certainly experiences like the PolyMet, North Met mine in Minnesota and the rare element resources Bear Lodge rare earth deposit closer to my home in Wyoming show that it's difficult to predict when permits will be granted, when someone can start production, when revenues are going to start coming in to pay off loans or the investors in those mines. So many investors are hearing a sort of conflicted message from the federal government and the need for these kind of resources, but also extreme difficulty in making those things happen. While it's difficult to open new mines, that's also led to difficulty in having refining and processing or the midstream of the sector thrive. As many others have noted in previous testimony in here, the majority of refining and processing is occurring in China. So what that means is there's a sort of a coordination problem within the US where a firm can sign on with a new refiner to procure some of the minerals that it would need for its, say, downstream product. However, it competes in a market against other firms. And if those other firms don't join in and say the new domestic refiner and continue with a Chinese refiner, potential to undercut the costs and drive the firm that signed the new contract with the domestic refiner out of business. If all the firms in the US sort of came together and at once signed a contract to make the refining plant that would be built profitable, you know, we would have this coordination issue solved. So I look at things like the Department of Defense signing a Defense Production Act agreement with Lynas to help build a light rare earth refining facility in Texas as a way that sort of the Department of Defense is acting as this anchor customer. Others can have good faith that that refining facility will be there and will be in production. So the previous 2 points put together sort of suggest a high level of uncertainty for investors and for companies in the mining space. So relying on foreign raw and processed minerals in your downstream or, you know, the batteries, the magnets, all the issues that's been discussed already in your production process can be quite risky. You're lengthening out your supply chain. That would lead then one to sort of choose to do that production somewhere else or closer to where the minerals are coming from, losing the associated jobs in that downstream sector to the US industry. So reducing this level of risk in the mining industry just helps reduce risk overall and ensure that the US can maximize its gain from the energy transition occurring today. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I'm happy to address any questions committee members may have.
Thank you, Dr. Lang, for highlighting those economic and security supply chain issues that I know we're all concerned about. I want to now go to Ms. Wolf. You're recognized to testify for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Ranking Member Westerman and distinguished members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before this forum today. Today, we find ourselves grappling with the same issues that confronted us more than a decade ago when China first limited exports of rare earth elements to Japan, a close American partner. This confrontation first alerted us and our allies to the scale at which these and other minerals underpinned our advanced technologies. It also revealed key vulnerabilities in a race we were not yet fully aware existed for the energy, defense, transportation, and technology innovations of the future. Make no mistake, we are in this race today and we are behind. The world is witnessing a massive transformation to an increasingly electric, connected, and autonomous future built on batteries and critical minerals. China has been planning for this transition for the last 30 years, while the United States is just waking up to the problem. This is not just a race for who controls the raw materials. It is also a race for the innovation and expertise that flow from the advanced manufacturing that relies upon them. During the last crisis, I was in the midst of studying the trace element chemistry of lepidolite in a type of a rock called a pegmatite. For those of you who did not study geology, a pegmatite is a coarse-grained igneous rock enriched in rare earth elements and lithium. After the last crisis, I turned my attention to national security regarding critical and rare earth minerals. Today, I lead SAFE's Center for Critical Mineral Strategy to help ensure America has a secure, ethical, and responsible supply of the minerals necessary to support our economic and national security. SAFE is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization that advances transformative transportation and mobility technologies and ensures key aspects of the technology supply chain to enhance the United States' energy security, support its economic resilience, and maintain its strategic advantage. Over the last several years, SAFE has grown increasingly concerned with China's rising dominance in key parts of the automotive and battery manufacturing supply chain, particularly their control over vital midstream components, including processing and anode and cathode production. As SAFE laid out in its recent Commanding Heights of Global Transportation report, China exerts significant influence over these aspects and uses its power not only to cut off supplies, but also to lure foreign investment and advanced manufacturing to its shores. Just as the United States has Silicon Valley as a cradle for domestic and international investment, China seeks to create its own high-level industrial center based on critical minerals. We must resist becoming just the assemblers of next-generation technology. We must act now to break China's stranglehold on this emerging market. Batteries power everything from computers and cars to soldiers and satellites. While battery chemistry is rapidly changing, to meet the projected technological demand, we will need lithium, nickel, cobalt, and manganese-based cathodes, graphite-based anodes, and copper-based current collectors. Additionally, most EV motors and many precision-guided munitions rely on permanent magnets, which are primarily made of neodymium, iron, and boron, and draw their power from the unique chemical properties of rare earth elements. China is the world's largest processor of nickel, copper, cobalt, lithium, and rare earth elements. It controls 75% of lithium-ion battery production, including 60% of the world's cathode production and 80% of the world's anode production. We, by contrast, remain import-reliant for more than half our supplies of these materials, except for copper. Even minerals produced here will likely be sent to China for processing into usable goods. This is a problem. Dependence on our 21st century near-peer competitor is a massive national economic security threat and diminishes our ability to project soft power and lead the world into the next industrial revolution. Today, due to their control over mineral supplies, the world is looking to China to lead the way, not the United States. This limits not only our ability to manufacture the necessary goods for our economic security and national defense, it also limits our ability to respond appropriately when confronted with situations that go against our American ideals, including the ongoing crises in Xinjiang and Hong Kong. While incredibly important, we cannot yet recycle our way out of this problem. We simply do not have enough of the original raw material necessary to recycle to meet projected needs. Both the World Bank and the International Energy Agency project that even with recycling, we will require large investments in mineral resources to meet projected clean energy needs, including almost 6 million more tons of aluminum, more than 1 million more tons of copper, and almost 500% increases in graphite, lithium, cobalt through 2050 compared to 2018 levels. The United States and our allies have the resources, expertise, and high environmental and labor standards to ensure that new production is done safely and sustainably, but we lack the comprehensive mapping information needed to know exactly where our resources are to make effective land use planning decisions that balance our national and economic security, resource needs with environmental and community protection. To surpass China in this race for the future, the U.S. must do at least three things. First, we must establish a systematic approach to mapping our mineral resources by bolstering the U.S. Geological Survey's Earth MRI program, which works side by side with state geologists to understand our resource potential. Second, we must work to break China's stranglehold on minerals processing by unleashing the private sector's economic potential and allowing them to create a rare earths processing cooperative, as well as committing to reprocessing existing mine waste and clean up our abandoned mine lands. And finally, we must create a market for goods produced at home and among our allies and partners using blockchain to ensure that goods that go into our tech-driven world are sourced using the highest environmental and humanitarian standards. Thank you for this opportunity, and I look forward to discussing these solutions with you further.
Thank you, Ms. Wolf. It's obvious you've got a lot of expertise, and thank you for sharing that with us and for your passion for this and the great work that SAFE is doing. Next, I want to recognize the gentleman from Idaho, Mr. Fulcher, to introduce our next witness.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and it's an honor to introduce another Idahoan in the group here today, and I'd like to introduce Laurel Sayer. Laurel is the president and CEO of Perpetua Resources. Her passion and skill of bringing people together to identify solutions that work together for the environment and for business, and her background in federal and natural resource policy guides her leadership of the Stibnite Gold Project as it moves through the regulatory process. Before her current role as CEO, Laurel served as a director on the company's corporate board for 2 years. Laurel spent more than two decades of working on natural resource issues with Congressman Mike Simpson and Senator Mike Crapo, two of my colleagues still in office today. Through this time, she gained a reputation for creating meaningful relationships and delivering results while working with local, state, and federal government agencies. Laurel believes that industry and the environment can and must work together to restore a site and improve the economy of rural communities. She's proud to be surrounded by a team of experts working to bring the project to life. Laurel knows some of the best trails in the Sawtooth Wilderness and loves spending time in Idaho's beautiful outdoors, making memories with her family. Mr. Chairman, thank you. And Laurel, it's all yours.
Thank you. And thank you for this opportunity to talk about the Stibnite Gold Project. So why should we be mining critical minerals in America? Well, simply put, because we do it better here at home. And mining in America provides us control over our future. Domestic production gives us direct access to the materials we need, brings with it American jobs and American infrastructure, and puts the social and environmental conditions of mining in our hands. Bringing mining home is the right decision for the Stibnite Gold Project in Idaho, and is a great example of how it can be done with the economic and environmental benefits. Our vision for the Stibnite Gold Project is to use responsible mining at an abandoned mine site to restore the environment and then leave the area better than it is today, to partner with our communities and bring family wage jobs and infrastructure, and to produce the minerals and metals that are critical for the American future. The Stibnite Mining District has seen over 100 years of mining activity, but most of the mining at Stibnite occurred around World War II, and on the eve of the war, the blockade in the Pacific cut off the United States from our only source of tungsten and antimony needed for the war effort. The U.S. found both at the Stibnite Mining District, which ended up producing the majority of tungsten and antimony used during the war years. Many years later, three CERCLA decrees functionally abandoned this site. The legacy of Stibnite, it's complicated. On one hand, the men and women of Stibnite are credited with having shortened World War II by a year and saving a million American lives. And then on the other hand, most of the mining here occurred long before the environmental regulations or an ethos on how to leave the site after mining. As a result, there is an environment legacy that needs to be addressed. And today, Stibnite needs help. The East Fork of the South Fork of the Salmon River flows into an abandoned mining pit. Steelhead, Chinook, and bull trout have been blocked from miles of critical habitat for over 80 years. And millions of tons of legacy tailings, they're degrading the water quality. The good news is, industry has a solution. We designed our project to be the long-awaited environmental solution. Through mining, we can help fish migrate to miles of critical habitat. We can pick up millions of tons of old tailings to improve water quality, and we can permanently restore the river. The mineral resources that make the restoration component of the project possible, to date, we have identified reserves of 4.8 million ounces of gold and 148 million pounds of the critical mineral antimony. Antimony, while lesser known, is vital to our everyday lives and to our nation's future. In defense, antimony is critical for infrared technology and munitions. In technology, antimony is in iPhones and semiconductors. In energy, antimony is in wind turbines and batteries. And a lower carbon energy grid demands storage. Emerging technology around antimony, molten salt batteries are showing promise as the large capacity, long-term energy storage we need to meet our carbon reduction goals. Today, there are no domestic mine sources of antimony. Instead, China, Russia, and Tajikistan control over 90% of the world production. The Stibnite Gold Project is one of the largest reserves in the world outside of Chinese and Russian control, and Stibnite could provide an average of 35% of U.S. demand in our first 6 years of operation. Bringing a project to life takes time and careful consideration. After 6 years of study, we submitted our plan of restoration and operations to the Forest Service in 2016. We are approaching our fifth year of NEPA permitting. Once permitted, it will take 3 years to get through construction and into production. Our regulatory system's high standards is science-based and incorporates public feedback. This is great, but it is also inefficient if it takes an average of 7 to 10 years to go through permitting. As a conservation and a female CEO, I can tell you that the face of American mining has changed. For us, transparency and accountability have guided our interaction with communities. Diversity and inclusion define our team leadership all the way through our company. And we are investing in environmental solutions because it's the right thing to do. This country needs a path forward on climate, on jobs, and on secure supply chains. The Stibnite Gold Project is the perfect example that American mining is the solution, and American mining is ready to help. My ask to you is to find the bipartisan path forward. We need timeline businesses and the American people can count on. 10 years is too long of a wait for the climate solutions, the infrastructure and the jobs we need today, and permitting agencies need resources and a unified directive to make it happen. Thank you for letting us talk about the Stibnite Gold Project.
Thank you, Ms. Sayer, and what an exciting project you've got there. I can't wait to maybe someday get out and visit it, but I think it's a great example of how the environment and the economy, mm-hmm. and not to mention national security, can benefit all at the same time. So thank you for sharing that. We're now gonna go to questions from members. We're going to go by seniority on the committee, and I want to remind members that there's a 5-minute limit on questions, and we're going to start off with the vice ranking member of the committee from Texas, Mr. Gohmert.
Great, thank you. Well, I would like to go to Ms. Sayer that just spoke. Yes, I'm wondering if we did allow for the mining of this critical mineral antimony, and you're right about how important that is to our national defense, so many things. If we allowed mining of antimony wherever it was in the United States, do you have any idea what percentage we could produce, or are we just destined to be relying on China and Russia for that?
Sawyer, you're muted. Or Sayer, you're muted.
Sayer. There we go.
I'm sorry, Sayer, yeah.
So our project would be able to produce 35% of the antimony needed in the U.S. during the first 6 years of production. So we would be basically the only supplier of antimony because we're already in the permitting process. We probably could get out there into production first to be able to help this need of antimony in the U.S.
But is there, I don't know how widespread the existence of antimony is in the United States. And that's what I'm getting at, because let's face it, if we didn't cause years and years of effort to try to get a permit and make it so difficult, if people could mine it as it is, could we produce more than 35% of our own need? It might take an additional company or two, but I'm just wondering how much is there out there that we know of?
Well, I can tell you that the number I gave of 35% is what we are in the process of being permitted to do. But right. I do know that there are reserves of antimony in the U.S. Outside of the area that we have ready to permit. I mean, that are within our permit. So Idaho has some strong antimony stibnite areas in it. They're all over the U.S. in the U.S.
Yes. So, thank you, Ms. Sayer. Since I've been on natural resources, which is 16 years, it just seems like we are constantly taking more and more of our rare earth minerals and in general minerals off limits. They cannot be produced no matter how nicely the land is put back better than before. It doesn't matter. We're putting more and more off limits. And I've just seen us as a nation continue to cut off our nose to spite our face. As I mentioned to President Trump some years back, I said, you know it just from your business acumen. I know it from studying history that any major nation that cannot produce what it needs in a time of war will not be a great nation after the next war. And I've seen our nation over and over putting millions of acres of land off limits to anything. And these rare earth minerals are really getting more and more precious to keeping a sophisticated country going. So anyway, I'm extremely concerned about our future if we cannot produce what we need. Let's face it, if we had took a stand against China expanding their boundaries, there's a good chance they're not going to provide us what they have been and what we need to keep going. So I really appreciate our ranking member, Mr. Westerman. Thank you for hosting this forum. It is so important to whether or not we have a future as a country that we look at these things and make sure we tend the garden God gave us, but we use it wisely and use what we have. And I thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Louis. And next, I want to recognize the gentleman from Idaho, Mr. Fulcher, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Laurel, this is directed to you as well. And the Stibnite project in Idaho is one that I know a little bit about, but here's a scenario, if I understand correctly, where during World War II, miners were told to go out and produce these rare minerals and just go, because there was a war effort and there was a desperate need for minerals there, and they did. And to your point during your testimony, the regulatory requirements and frankly the need necessitated that this was done in haste because there was a major war effort going on. But that has now led to a scenario where you're in hindsight, you're kind of having to atone for sins that weren't sins at the time. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I'm explaining that appropriately, but here's a project that you're having to put into current standards when the project was underway, those standards didn't exist at all. So where do you stand with that? And what are the roadblocks to getting your project approved with the Stibnite project right now?
Well, I can tell you that, Mr. Fulcher, that if we did not have the Stibnite Gold Project, if it weren't to happen, we definitely would be left in that area of Idaho, would be left the way it is. And that would mean that the East Fork of the South Fork of the river would continue to dump into that yellow pine pit that you've seen. I know you've been there and seen that. The salmon would continue to be blocked. Water quality would continue to be degraded. We wouldn't have the private investment in roads and rural Idaho with 500 family jobs. And America would not have a domestic supply of antimony, which leaves us vulnerable and not in control of our own destiny. And our roadblocks today, I believe, are that we are challenged with an environment of where federal agencies are challenged. Let me just give you an example. Like, I think that we need two things to happen and to help us get through those roadblocks that we have. One, first off, I know that American mining is ready. We are ready. We have the ability, but we need two things to happen. One, we need our federal agencies unified and coordinated to make it happen. The ingenuity and the need for a new wave of green technology requires government to partner with American businesses, and investors are here. They're willing to fund the opportunity, but business can't wait for 10 years. Climate solutions, they can't wait for 10 years. Reclaiming our future can't wait for 10 years. So we are ready, and mining is ready. We know we can do it better anywhere than anywhere else in the world, but we need coordination and focus from our agencies and a timeline that businesses, they can count on. And the second one is pro-mining is not anti-environment. We must stop listening to this narrative that you choose one over the other. In fact, the right environmental choice is to mine here, where it has a lower environmental impact. And the right labor choice is to mine here. The right safety choice is to mine here. And the right national security choice is to mine here. America has the minerals, we have the workers, and the safety and environmental regulations to do it right. And when we push mining offshore to places we will never see, to people we will never meet, and we forfeit all our influence and our control over how these things we need are produced, we can build it better here and operate it better than anywhere else in the world. So we need to have that settled.
Thank you, Laurel. And I think I'm about out of time. So I'm just going to paraphrase what I think you said in a couple of sentences. With the Stibnite project, in order to proceed with that or to proceed with that actually creates a win-win. It cleans up a project that was put in place during World War II for all the right reasons of that time, and it improves the environment, and it opens up access domestically for critical minerals that we are dependent on our enemies today for. Have I correctly paraphrased that?
Absolutely. Perfectly. In less time than I took.
Thank you, Laurel. Thank you, Ms. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. I also thank him for his leadership as the ranking member on the Public Lands Subcommittee. And next, I see Representative Gosar is available now. Paul leads as the ranking member on the Oversight Subcommittee. Mr. Gosar, you're recognized for 5 minutes. You're still muted, Paul.
Can you hear me now? There you go. Gotcha. Good. Thank you, Ranking Member Westerman. Ms. Sayer, I love your comments, coming from Arizona, we've actually seen that investment go through, and we've seen a group that says, no, you can't mine here, and we won't allow mining anywhere. I'm from Arizona, so that's the home of Raul Grijalva as well. And we actually have a mine that they've actually invested almost $2 billion in to mitigate the mine site from previous times and to get ready to mine copper. And now they want to try to renege on it. The problem's not this group of people here. We're the solutions. That's where the issue is. And what we have to do is we have to take these teaching moments to teach America that this isn't, like you said, your grandfather's mining. And take them due diligently through each strata and case in point. So going back with Resolution Copper, one of the things that I've always asked them to do is, what would you like me to do? I want you to take your promises and show them. Take people through the mine. Show them the water quality. Show them the mine, old mine sites. Show them the tailing aspects, because that's what works. Because we have neglected this aspect from the teaching. We've allowed the other side to have the narrative. So I think that's critical right now, because as Arizona goes, I mean, you know, Dan will tell you, we got rare earths, you know, out the wazoo, you know, late over in the west side. I mean, we've got nodules of stuff laying around the deserts. And then as, you know, copper goes, you got a bunch of those as well. Plus we have a major lithium find. So this is all going to be critical to that aspect. The other thing is we, through the Western Caucus, we tried to look at streamlining the process under the previous administration, and we got somewhere. The problem is that when you get an administration like we have now, who doesn't want to do that, and that hatred is so bad, it would just wipes everything off the map, and it empowers the bureaucrats. And so I think there's a fundamental problem that we got there. We got to break that. So I'm going to get my questions. Mr. McGroarty, thank you. And thank you for all that you do for us in Arizona. I know you focused on an amendment updating the tax depletion list to include all critical minerals. But in your view, is the United States government currently using the tools in existing federal law to promote domestic critical mineral development and production?
Well, thank you. Thank you, Congressman Gosar. And it's great to see you again. I would have to say your question focuses on existing federal law, and I'd have to say there, the United States government is not fully using all the tools at its disposal. I will focus on one by way of example to answer your question. In the National Defense Stockpile statute, which has been in existence, stockpile was first chartered in 1939, the Defense Production Act, which has been amended many times, but dates back to 1950, both of those laws on the books now have a section which where they authorize what they call commitments to purchase for metals, minerals, materials, commitments to purchase. In the mining world, that's understood to be an offtake contract, a future contract to produce into. And as I've looked at that, neither of those tools which exist now, so they don't have to be pushed through the Congress of the moment where very little is happening without all kinds of stress. But neither these things haven't been used, as far as I can tell, since the U.S.-Soviet Cold War days in terms of that. Now, offtake agreements, it's interesting. And we're, as folks who are free market advocates, we don't want the government picking winners and losers. We don't want them choosing which mine, which project. But there's a way around that. You can structure an offtake contract so that you can make it non-exclusive. You can put them out for a specific material. You can pick dysprosium among the heavy rare earths for permanent magnets and for weapon systems. Happens to be on the National Defense Stockpile list right now, right? So put out a five-year offtake contract, dysprosium with a formula to determine what the price will be, and to certain specifications. If the product doesn't meet spec, government doesn't have to buy it. And you can put it out to multiple rare earth projects, right? First past the post, you're not picking a winner and loser, right? The federal government spends about $10 million a minute this year, as far as I can figure out. If we took 1 minute of federal spending for one contract for $10 million, let's say 5 years, it would be dramatically important. I would say that because my discussions with other folks in the private sector, capital will look at that as a strong signal, private capital. I would say confidently that an offtake agreement for $10 million would likely be met by private capital times 10, $100 million coming in. No additional cost to the American taxpayer, right? And no cost to the federal government if that material isn't produced and doesn't meet spec. So I would say, you know, 1 minute of federal spending. Can you imagine 1 hour of federal spending? And 1 hour of federal spending with offtakes, we could transform the critical minerals development path. And that legislation is in the National Defense Stockpile. It's in the DPA right now.
Dan, thank you. My time is up. I think there's some creative aspects that we can do, and I thank you for living outside the box.
Thanks.
Thanks. I yield back.
Nice to live.
Thank you, Paul. And now it's a privilege to recognize the ranking member on the Energy and Minerals Subcommittee, someone who I've visited his district, and I've visited current mining operations and proposed mining operations. Representative Stauber, recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Westerman. I appreciate your leadership in hosting this Zoom call. And thank you to all the witnesses for joining us today, whether it be the recent report from the IEA or testimony from our witnesses. It is clear that we need further access to critical minerals, building roads, buildings, electric vehicles, or anything else. America's access to massive amounts of minerals is necessary. Fortunately, Northern Minnesota and the Duluth Complex are ready and able to lead. Located squarely in my district where we have a generational and cultural mining legacy, the Duluth Complex has the copper, nickel, cobalt, platinum group elements and others needed occurring alongside our taconite. Our miners built America and defended her during wars with our steel. Let's do it again with our precious metals. Mr. McCordy, in your testimony, you mentioned an all of the above strategy to reduce our import dependence. My district contains 95% of America's nickel and 88% of its cobalt. Our projects have shown the American ingenuity you discussed by committing to dry stack tailings and other ingenious methods. Is there any way we can meet the president's green energy goals without developing the minerals we're blessed with in northern Minnesota?
I think without question, the answer to that would be no, we cannot. And I think that Mr. Gould and the IEA have done a signal service in terms of indicating how many multiples of material that we're going to need to meet these ambitious goals. And Congressman, as you know, these are just, this is to make the renewable energy transition. This is not to meet our national security needs for defense systems and so on and so forth. I will say, I have to respond a couple of points about the deposit and the project that you mentioned in your state. First of all, it's a good indication that the things that, that we have to be mindful of are multi-metal deposits. So here you have nickel and cobalt. And in fact, in the application of electric EV batteries, but more broadly lithium ion batteries, you need both cobalt and you need nickel as well. Nickel has not even been deemed by the US government a critical mineral, right? And yet the nickel projects where nickel is the dominant metal or mineral, cobalt is the co-product, I call it co-product rather than byproduct, because I don't want to have a debate as to which one's more important if both are necessary for a battery. They're both important, right? It is very peculiar to me to have industrial metals or minerals like nickel, which are the gateway to these tech metals, not that are recognized as critical, but those primary industrial materials, metals and minerals are not themselves treated as critical. Personally, I speak for myself on this, I think that the lithium ion battery applications, whether they're EV or whether they're military drones and everything in between, whether they're rechargeable batteries that are implantable for people in medical, for medical devices, right? I think all those things are so important that there should be attention given to whether those materials as a group, the so-called battery materials as a group, shouldn't be looked at as Title III eligible, Defense Production Act Title III eligible. Right now, only the rare earths are. And I don't understand why some of these other complexes of critical minerals aren't elevated to that same status.
You bring up a really good point, and we are working on that. I want to follow up on what my colleague, Representative Gostar, was talking about, the NEPA process and et cetera. There's one company that is in its 19th year of permitting, 19 years. They've been trying to get these precious and critical minerals out. And so reforming the process, as Representative Gosar and Westerman and others on this call have called for. I just have a couple, another minute or so here. This question is for Ms. Wolf. Thank you so much for joining. And I agree completely with your testimony. We need to further grow our midstream and downstream mineral development to compete with China once again. Last Congress, I proposed a tax deduction that would make it easier for manufacturers to purchase domestically smelted goods. Could you discuss further how a deduction like the one I proposed and similar measures can benefit not only extraction, but processing, smelting, and manufacturing?
Thank you, Representative Stauber. As you mentioned, SAFE has been reviewing your legislation, and we really appreciate the work that you and your office have done to sort of look into this very critical issue. In RI, it is important to look at the entire supply chain when it comes to critical mineral resources for electric vehicles and batteries. So in our view, on its face, efforts to incentivize domestic responsible supply chain production for critical minerals are always a good thing. And we really appreciate you and your office's foresight into coming up with some solutions to the challenges that we're facing in this arena.
I appreciate that. And my time's just about run out. And I just want to thank Chair Westerman for your leadership and all of you participating. It matters. We have to bring this these opportunities using the best environmental labor standards, and we do it the best here in the United States. I yield back.
Thank you, Pete, and thank you again for the job you do leading on our side on the Energy and Minerals Subcommittee. I now want to go to Representative from Wisconsin, Mr. Tiffany. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you very much, and I appreciate the thought that Representative Stauber just put forward in regards to Chairman Westerman. We look forward to it. I wish I could ask questions of all of you, but because you all had very good testimony. But there's a couple things that I'd like to cover. Mr. Girardi, up in the district that I represent, far northern Wisconsin, there's a bunch of iron slag heaps up there. Is there a potential up there for some of those that are left over from the iron mines that they may have some of those minerals?
You're muted.
I'm back. Okay. Absolutely. There's no question that these secondary recoveries or unconventional recoveries ought to be looked at. I mentioned in my all of the above litany reclamation, and that is very, very important. Congressman Tiffany, I don't know whether any of those deposits, former mines, are abandoned mine lands. I don't know what status they are in terms of any cleanup that they might require, but we all know that those types of cleanups are extraordinarily expensive, and the lists are very, very long, and they sit and sit for decades, and they just don't get acted on. When we look at iron ore, you can look geologically and make estimates as to what other metals and minerals might be traveling along with it. And we wouldn't have sought them at the time because we didn't have uses for them. We wouldn't have been looking for rare earths before we had the microcomputing revolution. We wouldn't have been looking for at least a dozen metals and minerals that are on the critical list because we had no uses for them. So the first thing is to go back in there and to do some assessment, to pull some material just off the surface and see what the mineral endowment really is. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Mr. Gould, I was just looking through. I get a feed every day with some current news going on around the world. And this is a little bit away from what we're talking about today, but I found it interesting. It says investment in new fossil fuel supply projects must immediately cease if the world is going to slash net carbon emissions to zero by 2050, the International Energy Agency said. The IEA also said that hitting the net zero target would require a rapid acceleration of wind and solar and a halt in sales of combustion engine cars by 2035. Is that the official position of the IEA?
Thank you very much, Representative Tiffany. We issued this morning, in fact, a new piece of analysis. It was a scenario analysis looking at what would be required if the world were to reach net zero emissions globally by 2050. So setting that as a target, we worked backwards to the present day, and we came back with a number of conclusions about the dramatic changes that would be necessary in order to reach that target. And the two that you've mentioned are in the report. So the declines that would be required in oil and natural gas demand would be such that they would be met by existing fields and fields that have been approved for development already as of this year. So that's correct. And it's also correct that a 2035 for ending sales of cars with internal combustion engines.
But it's not an official position of the IEA that you're calling for that. You're saying that this was something, a projection that you put together?
So we are translating the discussion around net zero 2050 globally into an understanding of what would be required in order to get there. So I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, terrific. That thank you very much. Ms. Wolf, what's it going to take? This is kind of per Representative Gohmert's comment. What's it going to take to get people to understand that we really do need these critical minerals, and we need minerals generally being mined here in our country in order for us to be able to continue to be a global superpower and a prosperous country in the 21st century? What did you see an event that can happen that will jar Americans into an understanding that, hey, this is what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen if we don't get going here.
So the event that sort of kicked off my interest in this whole field was back in 2010 with the Sino-Japanese crisis in the East China Sea, where China cut off Japan's supplies to rare earth elements. And so that's definitely an area we can look to history and see what can happen when these critical and rare earth elements are cut off to techno-democracies, fellow techno-democracies of ours. We can also take a look and see during the pandemic what's been happening with the shortage of semiconductors, which are very geographically sort of constrained. So, you know, we need to make sure that we have diverse supplies, and making sure that we have secure domestic supplies is one way that we'll be able to make sure that we have the things that we need for our midstream and downstream ecosystems.
Yeah, thank you so much for that answer. And Representative Westerman, thank you for the time. I have so many more questions for these folks, and I'll probably deliver some of them offline. But I just wanted, Representative Stauber was talking about the percentage of the various minerals they have in northern Minnesota. If northern Wisconsin would really get after it, as someone who rewrote the mining law in Wisconsin, where we probably have $20 to $30 billion worth of minerals that we could mine, we think we could give Minnesota a run for its money. Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Tom. We're going to now go out to a gentleman from Montana, Mr. Rosendale. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thanks so much, Ranking Member Westerman. And thank you for organizing the forum to discuss the most important issues facing the future of energy in our country. One thing I want to make extremely clear, and that's if you believe that we should transition to greener energy alternatives, you must support the mining of critical minerals. It's not possible to, in good faith, support the former without the latter. That's because everything from electric vehicles to solar panels to windmills all rely on an incredible amount of these minerals. A single wind turbine, for example, can contain 335 tons of steel, 4.7 tons of copper, 3 tons of aluminum, and over 700 pounds of rare earth minerals. These minerals need to be mined, and where they are mined matters a lot. The United States has some of the most stringent environmental and labor standards for mining of any nation on earth. Unfortunately, the country with a near monopoly on mining for many of these critical minerals is China. In mining these minerals, China poisons water and soil with contaminated mine waste, creates what are known as cancer villages due to unsafe mine practices, and relies on Uyghur slave labor and tragic human rights abuses to do so. If this was not reason enough to work on onshore production, the national security implications are extremely serious. With our reliance on China for so many of these critical minerals, any disruption in our supply of these minerals from China would be disastrous. And the Chinese Communist Party know that. And they can choose to disrupt our supply for any strategic reason or no reason at all. So, Ms. Wolf, can you discuss some of the consequences to the United States that would occur due to a supply shock of Chinese critical minerals?
Yes, thank you very much, Representative Rosendale, for that question. So at SAFE, you know, we're very invested in making sure that we have everything that we need throughout the critical mineral supply chain for the electric vehicle, transportation, and battery future of the United States and of our allies. So we would like to make sure that the United States and our allies are making decisions that are making sure that we are not allowing ourselves to become dependent solely on China or other nations that do not share our same values. We realize that we cannot recycle our way out of this issue and that we will need production, but we want to make sure that all production is done to the highest environmental and labor standards that we have. And we do believe that we have those within the United States and among our allies.
Has anybody done any analysis on how much of the production could be fulfilled with just recycling products? Because we often hear that from the left.
I believe my fellow panelist, Tim Gould from the EIA, or perhaps the World Bank Group, have also done some analysis on this subject when it comes to the amount that can be produced from recycling. And while we believe it's safe that it is important to invest in recycling these materials and to research new ways to improve recycling, we do recognize that we will probably need more domestic production and allied production to meet these goals.
Sure. Tim, if you want to comment on that, that would be great.
Thank you very much, Representative. Yes, in our recent analysis, we did look at this question. We're going to have an awful lot more spent EV batteries, you know, coming on towards the end of this decade and into the 2030s. And our estimate is that, it was mentioned up front by Ranking Member Westerman, but recycling these kinds of volumes wouldn't eliminate the need for continued investment in new supplies. We estimate that by 2040, recycled quantities of copper, lithium, nickel, and cobalt from spent batteries could reduce combined primary supply requirements for these minerals by around 10%.
10%. Okay, yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you. And Dr. Lang, can you talk about some of the regulatory barriers that exist to expanding production of these minerals and how that can be addressed?
Yes, happy to. So there's certainly on the upstream side with new mines, it's certainly the NEPA process. That's a large part of the issues that bring risk to the table. So we are aware of firms who have either, you know, run out of money as they're waiting for the NEPA permit to happen and thus have to sort of close up operation, or as some has been explained here before, you know, people waiting 19 years in order to get something done. And clearly whatever planning you had have done, you would have done 19 years ago, things have changed and you have to sort of restart. So just the whole process of putting up a new mine is extremely difficult to predict and make plans on for the future.
Thank you so much. It looks as if my time is up, but I'd just like to say we have these minerals here in the United States, and for the sake of our environment, for our economy, and for national security, we must take advantage of that. Thank you so much. Ranking Member Westerman.
Thank you, Matt. Now we're going to go to the gentleman from Utah, Mr. Moore. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman. Excited for the opportunity. Way I look at this, this is pretty simple. To do a lot of the things that we all want to do, we need critical minerals. We cannot rely on, you know, international adversaries or allies to do all of this and just expect it. We cannot have it both ways. Like this is one of those things that should be pretty straightforward and simple, but it's not, and it gets bogged down. So I appreciate this hearing today. Let me pepper a few questions that'll be related to that, starting with this is sheer nature of how important this is to our consumer, business, and defense industries. I'll start with Mr. Blakemore. Obviously, great name, by the way. As a Blakemore myself, what are our allies? And this can continue on from Ms. Wolf's comments. What are our allies and adversaries abroad doing to expand their refining capacity? So let's get really specific here. Expanding their refining capacity, and what can we do to, you know, better either keep up or stay at an advantage or stay out ahead of this?
Thank you, Congressman. And appreciate the name recognition there. When speaking about our allies, I think the natural partners who are interested, particularly in the midstream section, are Japan, Australia, and Canada. And in a way, they're already beginning. They're a few steps ahead of us in some cases. Japan, since the Sino-Japan crisis 2010 that Ms. Wolf mentioned, has been looking at the resiliency measures, particularly in the midstream. They've launched a program called ABCD plus R, which looks at a range of different options, including diversifying away from Chinese-based inputs, as well as finding, introducing recycling programs, et cetera. So there are opportunities with Japan. Europe, our partners in Europe are also beginning to look at specific processing and refining plants as well. The problem really ultimately is developing the scale of inputs into those processing facilities to really allow those alternatives to succeed scaling quickly. So I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you. Mr. McGrory, I understand that Rio Tinto recently announced plans to build a tellurium plant in the Kennecott mines in my home state of Utah, which, again, back to this not having it both ways, that'll help manufacture solar cells. Generally speaking, can you talk through some of the biggest regulatory challenges that the industry will face while expanding operations?
Yeah, I think many of the panelists, Congressman, I'm happy to provide my input on that. Many of the panelists have talked about the permitting challenges here. I won't track over that ground again. I would say in terms of challenges, rather incentives or opportunities, what's happening at the Kennecott copper operations there where the smelter is being used to recover tellurium, which would have otherwise just been lost to the tails. I mentioned in my comments both tellurium and rhenium, the same type of thing. Tellurium and rhenium are never really going to be mined, or at least not in the foreseeable future. They're not going to be mined in their own right. They're going to be captured as a co-product, or they're going to be lost to tails. If rhenium goes up the smokestack, rhenium is a pollutant, right? If rhenium is captured, it's used in turbines of jet fighters, right? So it all depends on whether we capture it, whether we don't. In terms of incentives, and I think that the work being done at Kennecott is a great example. I said we have to treat our smelters in the country. They're extremely expensive to build, expensive to maintain, and we have to treat them as the asset that they are. We should put in place some programs where we're looking at what other metals and minerals that are currently being lost to tailings could be recovered by these adaptations, as you're talking about here, tellurium being an example for solar, rhenium being an example, and there are others. We know that there's metals and minerals lost. And if we turned our smelters into critical mineral hubs, if we created some R&D around that, we'd learn about how much we would be able to recover. It wouldn't take a huge investment either.
Excellent, thank you. And my final question is probably something I always ask, and it's so crucial, is workforce. Professor Lang, at the Colorado School of Mines, what type of employment or enrollment trends are you seeing? Do we have the workforce needed for this? Is there enough interest? Is it supplemented by maybe international students, and are they going to stay and then leave? Like all those types of things. Any brief comment on that as I wrap up?
Yeah, there certainly are a decent number of international students on the mining engineering, metallurgy, and then also mineral economics side of things. And certainly the ability to work in the U.S. job market is very important. So issues around student visa and the OPT after that are super important to keeping those bright minds in the U.S.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. It looks like my time is up, so I'll yield back.
Thank you, Blake. And now we're going to go to the gentle lady from Colorado, Ms. Boebert. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Ranking Member Westerman. I greatly appreciate this forum and the opportunity to discuss an issue that House Democrats don't want to debate. Nearly 40,000 children are estimated to be mining in the Democratic Republic of Congo, where with their bare hands as we speak. More than 60% of the world's cobalt is produced in the Congo, where children work 12-hour days. They are enduring back-breaking labor and are paid a couple of dollars for their troubles. Miners in the Congo often undergo in unregulated mines where they frequently fall victim to terrible accidents or even death. In September of 2019, 50 miners in the Congo lost their lives and drowned. They drowned to death after a heavy rainfall in their makeshift mine. Cobalt mined by children in the Congo is typically sold to Chinese traders who then sell this critical mineral to companies in China for refining. Refined cobalt is commonly found in TVs, laptops, iPhones, and electric cars. Sacks are routinely mixed up on their way to China. And really, it's impossible to know who mined the cobalt in different bags, despite claims from large companies like Tesla, Samsung, Microsoft, and Apple. And they are no longer using so-called conflict minerals or minerals mined by children. The International Energy Agency estimates that we will need to produce at least 30 times as much lithium, cobalt, nickel, and other key minerals required by the electric car industry by 2040 to meet the radical goals of the Green New Deal extremists. And all the new mining to accomplish this liberal pipe dream would come from places like the Congo and not in the US. Why? Because despite having the highest standards and regulations in the world, House Democrats want to prevent any and all domestic mining. These not in my backyard extremists have made clear that they want to lock up our lands and that the mining of critical minerals and other important resources shouldn't take place anywhere else except for right here in America, where it would create good paying American jobs. In recent years, Democrats have led numerous partisan attacks on the mining industry, including supporting the withdrawal of 10 million acres in the West under the guise of protecting the non-endangered sage grouse, attacking a mining operation that would provide $3 billion for education in northern Minnesota in a forest twice authorized by Congress for mining, attacking a copper mine in Arizona that would create 4,000 jobs and generate $60 billion for our economy, and attempting to withdraw 1.7 million acres in northern Arizona in order to prevent mining of the critical mineral uranium. In all of these instances, there was some lie or in some exaggeration to protect the environment, but the truth is these leftists just don't support American mining. And we've seen this time and time again, including at their own committee hearings, where one of their witnesses couldn't name a single mine they supported. Democrats claim to be about human rights, but the reality is they don't care about those rights when violating them accomplishes their objective. It is unacceptable for these partisan hacks to continue to outsource our mineral production to countries who use child and slave labor. Yet less than 3 weeks ago, Democrats on the Natural Resource Committee rejected my common sense amendment that would have investigated whether the U.S. importing foreign minerals increases human trafficking and forced labor conditions. And I can go on and on about these hypocritical House Democrats, but I do have some questions for our witnesses. Mr. Steve Tressel, it is really great to see you and to have you here before us today, and I appreciate your support of several of my bills. Thank you very much. I want to ask, does it make sense to safely mine critical minerals in the U.S. where we have the highest standards in the world, or should this work be performed by children in the Congo with their bare hands?
Lauren, who was that question for?
Sorry, Mr. Tressel.
I don't think he's
on.
I don't think he's on.
Sorry about that.
I'll come on to
Mr. McGroarty.
I'd be happy to answer that, Congresswoman.
Sure.
Absolutely, we should not be doing that at all. And the points that you make about the child miners of DRC Congo, not only is it horrible down in the pit, but up at the top of the pit, there's very likely to be a warlord with a weapon, making sure that the children don't come up for any reason whatsoever. Statistically, although most folks don't want to think about it, with 70% of cobalt coming out of DRC Congo and then Western countries not wanting to touch it, it goes to China for processing into the advanced material. Statistically, we're very likely to have cobalt in our phones, Cobalt in our laptops, the ones that we're using now to conduct this forum. And yet it's not even on the critical, it's not even on the conflict metals list. I would say part of this starts with the efforts that you're making and your colleagues are making to raise awareness. And I know that sounds like a small thing, but we have to know what it is we're talking about here. I would say, you know, this is just the tip of the iceberg. There is graphite coming out of North Korea into China and being processed into our batteries that way. It's not coming out, you know, marked with a crate that says from North Korea. They're obviously surreptitiously bringing it out around any UN sanctions that might be in place. Heavy rare earths, we've just seen the anti-democratic coup in Myanmar. About half of the heavy rare earths, just that subset of rare earths coming into China, are from Myanmar. So from the generals and the junta running Myanmar, coming out, going into our EV batteries, going into our laptops, and going into our defense systems as well. Learning more, understanding more about how that's coming out of Myanmar, how that's being done with slave labor from Xinjiang, and the point you made about DRC Congo. When we have these metals and minerals in known resources here in the United States, we have to look at the human rights implications as you're doing. So I would encourage you, and I'd be happy to help in any way to make sure that's understood more broadly.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Rigordi. Thank you for answering that. Ranking Member Westerman, is how am I on time? Are we expired?
Yeah, I think you've exceeded your time.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I appreciate you.
Thank you. And now we're going to go to Representative Bentz from Washington. He's Oregon. He'll get on me for that. But he also serves as a ranking member on the Water Subcommittee. He's been waiting patiently, and I recognize you for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you for this most important hearing. And I just want to point out that Oregon does have one of the largest undeveloped lithium deposits. No surprise it's not developed. A question for Dr. Moats. You mentioned smelters. How long to bring a smelter online, assuming some sort of an interruption in our supply chain?
A greenfield site would probably take 3 to 5 years from go. If it's on a brownfield site, maybe a little bit less. So be it dependent if you're expanding existing operation or if there's a brownfield versus a greenfield.
Yeah. Question for Ms. Wolf. It appears that China is laundering all of these other minerals, as was mentioned earlier, no surprise. And it also appears that China is using, I'll call it the Amazon tactic of producing huge amounts of stuff and then selling it under market cost or production cost, so that it drives everybody in the world else, you know, else out of business. And then also creates a space between what it would cost us to make it and what they produce it for. That's generally going to dissuade people from filling that space with tax credits. Have I got that figured out correctly?
Yes, that is the position that we sort of see happening as well. At SAFE, we're very interested in examining the use of the new technology blockchain to sort of track mineral resources from mine to market, to track their provenance, to make sure that we are not penalizing our domestic producers here that are producing things to the highest environmental and labor standards, and making sure that we can develop supply chains in a race for the top in these emerging markets rather than in a race for the cheapest.
And then it has worked in other places to use certification devices, maybe on timber, where you certify that timber comes from a certain place and it's grown in a certain way. And so you use this certification methodology. Has that started to be used in mineral places where you try to embarrass different groups out of using stuff that's produced with child labor, or more to the point, putting us in really awkward positions?
So essentially, we definitely want to encourage people to use things that are responsibly sourced. And we're seeing a lot of market-driven approaches to this. There are consumers that are very interested in where their things are coming from and making sure that they're supplied sustainably. And there are a number of small startups. Europe is a little bit farther ahead of us in this space when it comes to meeting some regulations that have been put in place for the 3T minerals and gold, tin, tungsten, and tantalum, and making sure that we can help businesses sort of meet those standards, and also making sure that, again, we're providing sort of the sustainable marketplace for the good actors, like the ones domestically and with our allies that are producing these things in a responsible way.
Right. Well, who brings the greatest power to bear to actually force change? Is it Congress? Is it the public? Who is it that's actually going to make something happen, either on the production side or on the this, you know, try to clean up our act when it comes to exporting our bad sources?
We believe in sort of an all of the above approach to address this. We believe Congress can play a role, but also we want to make sure that consumers are pushing this as well, which we believe they are. Again, it's a little bit stronger of a movement in Europe right now, but in the United States, we are starting to see more of a move from consumers to see that their stuff is sourced sustainably. But we believe that, Congress, the administration should be looking at, setting these standards. It's always good to be the one to set the standards so that other people can be looking to us to be a good example and to promote our values sort of with our fellow techno democracies and partners.
Yeah, thank you, panel, for a wonderful presentation. I really appreciate your time. Thank you, Leader Westerman, and I yield back.
Thank you, Cliff. And I'm gonna recognize myself now for 5 minutes. As I mentioned earlier, my background's in engineering, and growing up and working in the engineering world, when you think about mining engineering, there's two schools that come to mind. It's the Colorado School of Mines and the University of Missouri at Rolla, and we have both of those schools represented in the hearing today. And these aren't just leaders in mining engineering in the United States, but literally global leaders in mining engineering, which tells me we have a illustrious past of mining in this country. There was great importance put on mining. And as a result, we've got these fine institutions. But what's happened over the years, I'll direct this to Dr. Moats and Dr. Lang, what's happened over the years that have caused us to lose this infrastructure? How do we get in the condition where we're having to rely on foreign countries for these critical minerals and resources when we're obviously blessed with those minerals and resources here domestically? We know that the jobs that are created by mining and processing and utilizing these materials are great jobs. They're not just a job, they're actually a career. You see communities and families that are built around these jobs. How do we get to the point where we're on a Zoom call today in Congress talking about our reliance on foreign supplies of these materials? And I ask that because we need to know what to avoid and what to change going forward so that it's not the case in the future. Dr. Moats.
Thank you. Well, I'll try to be brief. That's a really long question. It's a really long answer. I remember when I was first coming into the industry in 1983, Wall Street Journal ran a very famous piece that said, mining is dead. And I think that's propagated throughout our culture and our society that, there is no good miner in Hollywood. Every portrayal of a mining company executive, whatever, when it comes to a movie, they're always the evil one. They're tearing up the environment, they're destroying everything. And so I think it's a societal lack of recognition of the importance of where things come from. And as long as I can buy the cell phone or I can buy the car or I can buy the battery, it doesn't matter. So I think it's been a long, long, long decay of how important these things are. And also cleaning up sins of the past. I mean, I'll be frank. I mean, we did things in the past because we either didn't know it or we were too greedy. And so over the last 25 years, we've seen a substantial decline in mining and smelting. And that means that we've offshored all of those things and we've been kind of quite happy to take all of our pollution and shove it elsewhere. And now we're left over with this decayed mess that we have. And, quoting a Chinese proverb, a long trip takes a first step. And I think we need to start to turn that around by all the things that we talked about today. And I think the other thing is to try to figure out how to get young people excited about supplying these minerals. Most kids want to do an app or build robotics or do other things. Take SpaceX. We want to go mine asteroids, but we're not going to mine the thing down the road. So somehow in society, we have to say this is not only very needed, but it's a good opportunity, and it's something that should be encouraged. Those are my thoughts.
Thanks. Dr. Lang?
Yeah, as director of the Mineral and Energy Economics Program, it's 52 years old now. I will say all the more recent alums really took advantage of the fact that, you know, commodity markets are generally linked and moved into the oil and gas space, which sort of, you know, expanding much larger volumes in the last, say, 15 years or so. And I would say maybe in the last 2 or 3 years, we have a lot more interest in mineral finance and finding out ways to, encourage mining production and get involved in those industries again. So, I mean, I would say I've seen an upswing again back of interest in mining, whereas, 5 years ago, it was mostly an interest in oil and gas, and a slight few interest in mining. It's coming back as there, all the issues that we've discussed here today make the news.
Yeah, well, hopefully we can help promote that. You know, I face some of the similar issues advocating for sustainable forestry, and, much like Dr. Boats said, the actors in Hollywood are never portrayed as positive when they're miners, neither are anybody who cuts a tree down, even though it's one of the most green, sustainable things we can do to use wood products. To wrap up here, I just want to kind of go around the horn and ask all the witnesses if there's, one thing that you wish you had been asked that you didn't get asked, or something, some closing comments you want to share with the committee. And I'll start with Ms. Wolf.
Thank you much for the opportunity, Ranking Member Westerman. I think what everybody talked about here today has been very important. I think that one thing that I would emphasize is just making sure that we recognize that these minerals are the energy source of the future, and that the United States needs to take a much more systematic approach to mapping and understanding our resources here at home, so that we can make better land use planning decisions that balance sort of our resource needs with the environment and the community. And just highlighting investments from the US Geological Survey's Earth MRI program and the state geologists again that are doing remarkable work in this regard.
Thank you, Ms. Wolf. Mr. Blake Moore, and that's not the Congressman Blake Moore, it's Mr. Reed Blake Moore.
Thank you. Thank you to Ranking Member Westerman for inviting us here today, and to all the other distinguished members who asked questions. I might leave you with two thoughts which occurred to me as we spoke this afternoon. First is on the nature of risk. When we speak about risk in the mineral supply chain, I think there's two different types of risk we need to actually think about and clarify. There is the supply access risk, where we talk about minerals being cut off to the United States, and therefore incentivizing the U.S. having its own sort of access to those minerals, but also recognizing that that we are participating, one of many countries participating in a global marketplace for these minerals, right? And any behavior that we take to improve our own minerals access will still be put in relief to what China is doing and possibly supplying minerals to our European, Japanese, and us, to all of the other demand centers throughout the world. And when we think about policy response, we think about ways that actually raise norms across the board to allow US to be a norm exporter of a lot of these materials. The second item I'd say is related to the capital influx. And it's one item we didn't really touch on in that we have a significant investment need for these materials and minerals, and we can unlock additional capital for that investment if we begin to think about how we can seize the momentum from this growing field of ESG investing into the mining sector. And there's plenty of pools of capital there that can be accessed. And if we begin to think of ESG in a way that facilitates capital flows towards the minerals and materials we need for the energy transition, we'll actually find that investment can be easily unlocked to give us access to those new minerals and materials.
Thank you, Reed. Dr. Moats.
I have a couple, I'm sorry. All the tellurium that's produced in the United States from copper refineries are captured as an intermediate product and then exported before it's refined and brought back in as pure tellurium. So even the Kennecott plant is capturing it as a copper telluride. It has to be sent elsewhere. I'd like to point out that the Department of Energy is doing a really nice job with their Critical Materials Institute. I've been on several panels here recently, review panels. They are doing nice dollar for dollar cost matching for various critical mineral projects, demonstration, all the way up to almost basically commercial demonstrations. for lithium, cobalt, and various other critical rare earths. And so I think they're doing a nice job. We've recently become part of the Critical Materials Institute, and we have projects with the Doe Run Company here in Missouri, where we think we can produce 30% of the cobalt needs for chemicals from domestic sources here in Missouri. And we can do that for the next 10 years. And so we're working on that in a new project. And we're looking at gallium recovery from a zinc plant in North Carolina using steelmaking waste. And so we think we can make a substantial impact on gallium production here in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Motes. Ms. Sayer.
Thank you. I think our parting comments would be that American mining is ready. We have the ability to solve the critical mineral supply chain crisis and needs of this country. We simply need a permitting process, a permitting timeline that works for business and for our goals. So we're ready. We are the solution. We just need to have a bipartisan solution to help us keep moving forward.
Thank you, Ms. Sayer. Mr. Gould?
Yeah, thank you very much, Ranking Member Westerman. Maybe from our side, some reflections on energy security and how it plays into this discussion on minerals. Certainly from our perspective, I mean, we've been working on oil security for many decades. Naturally enough, one of the key elements of that is diversity of supply. But I think another element that I would like to leave you with is our realization that you can't just look at the supply side. You have to think holistically about all of the elements that go into a comprehensive approach to security. And that means thinking seriously about technology innovation. It means thinking deeply about, you know, recycling supply chains, the capacity to build up a domestic industry. It's also about elements like ESG and ESG investing, and also the element that we all typically come back to at the IEA, and that's the value of international collaboration in resolving some of these issues. Thank you very much for the opportunity today.
And thank you for being here. Mr. McGroarty.
Thank you, Chairman Westerman, for putting this forum together, first of all. And I'm so happy to be here with the other witnesses. It was a tremendous couple of hours, and I hope that it spawns some positive movement overall. I guess the two points would be a strong recognition that this really is the tech metals age. And so many of the things that we are trying to do as a country and that you and Congress are challenged to do, reviving American manufacturing, taking care of national security, making sure that we make a transition to renewable energy as quickly as we possibly can, making sure that we have independence when it comes to all these critical inputs. They all really are rooted in our metals and our mineral supply. And I guess, so that's the, we've never used more of the periodic table, and this is just the beginning. It's going to increase dramatically over the course of the 21st century. And I guess the other piece that I see as being related is, I touched on it a little bit, and that's to make sure that we have the proper mindset about the materials. We're very beguiled by the fact that all our signals come through the air and we store things in the cloud, and it's all kind of a form of magic, but it really is rooted in the materials. And we have to, I think, have that recognition, or the United States is not going to be able to play the leadership role that we want it to play. But thank you for putting the forum together.
And thank you, Dan, for being part of it. And finally, Dr. Lang.
Thank you, Congressman. Yeah, if I had another minute, I would probably just highlight the work that the Development Finance Corporation has started to do and hopefully will continue to do in bringing some of these critical mines online in allied countries, and then the ability to work with our partners like Canada and Australia to bring more of these minerals safely into the production. Thank you.
Thank you. And again, I want to thank all the witnesses. This has been very informative. I want to thank all the members for being on today, and also to the staff that put so much work into making this forum happen. This is an immensely important and complicated issue that really should be at the forefront of policy discussions in Congress. you know, this is only the beginning of the work that, that we need to do. And I hope to see us highlight it more and bring more attention to this so that the American people do understand what's at stake with our mining and with the supply chains for our critical minerals and rare earth elements. Again, I want to thank all the witnesses for your valuable testimony. Thank the members for their questions, and the roundtable is adjourned.